Let's look in our Bibles to St. Matthew chapter number 9. St. Matthew chapter number 9. I'm going to start my reading at verse number 35. St. Matthew chapter 9, verse number 35 through 38. And also we'll look at the 10th chapter, verse number 1. St. Matthew chapter 9, beginning at verse number 35 through 38. And also St. Matthew chapter 10, verse number 1. Please share your word with someone if they happen maybe not to have a Bible with them. We encourage all of you, make sure you bring your Bible to church. We have no problem if you want to use a Bible app, bring it up on your iPad or what have you. Sometimes it's convenient just to hit a button and not go through pages, but any way you can get the word, amen, feel free to do that in Jesus' name. St. Matthew chapter number 9, starting at verse number 35, and when you have the word, say with me, I have the word. All right, and in here, everybody, if you have it, say, I have the word. Okay, very good, very good. If you follow along silently, I want to thank and praise the Lord for my wife and for my son, for my mother-in-law, Mother Greg. We thank the Lord for her and all my sisters and brothers. I'm truly happy to see you, amen, in the house of the Lord this afternoon. As you follow along silently, and we thank the Lord for our viewers as we are streaming right now, we are the King's Chapel Assembly located 703 East Jefferson Boulevard. We are the church in the heart of the city with you in our heart, and we're happy once again that you've tuned in. Call up a friend and let them know that the Power of Pentecost telecast is on the air. In this ninth chapter of St. Matthew, starting at verse 35, as you follow along silently, I will read the word of the Lord aloud. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom. I like this, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Verse 37 lets us to know, then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Chapter 10, verse 1. And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits, to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Let's look to the Lord this afternoon. Dear God, in the name of Jesus, we come once again, not only in this building, but God, into your presence, honoring you that you're Lord of Lords and King of Kings. We pray that you examine our hearts once again as we come into this place. We desire, Lord, to hear a rhema word from you. Send the word to our heart, God. Prick our minds to be able to know you in a deeper dimension. Right now, we pray, Lord, that you would take us, Lord, by your grace, and give us knowledge and understanding, insight, God, as we start this week, that we might be directed by the Holy Ghost. We pray in the name of Jesus that someone that hears your word today will believe and go down in water baptism. Somebody today, Lord, will be buried in water baptism in the name of Jesus, and through faith, God, in your name, the blood will be applied. All their sins will be taken away, because we know there's healing in your name. Someone today, Lord, needs to be filled with the power of the Holy Ghost. They need their own day of Pentecost, and we pray in Jesus' name. Saturate them, anoint them, God. Fill them up even as they hear this word at this time. Bring back the backslidden today. Some are falling away, and some have been discouraged. Help them to know that today they hear their voice. Hear your voice, not to harden their heart. Help them to know, Lord, there is a place for them in the kingdom. We pray right now, Lord, for those that are in this congregation and those that listen to us by the way of the internet. Have your way every time and in every place, and we'll give you thanks. We'll give you praise and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. Let's give him worship once again for his goodness. Amen. God is good. As you look here, I'd like for you for a few minutes to look at verse number 36 in this ninth chapter I'd like to lift some words from verse number 36. The Bible says here, Jesus saw the multitudes, and he was moved with compassion. That's verse number 36. If you look at verse number 38, the Bible says that he sent forth laborers into his harvest. I want to talk to you this afternoon on the subject, moving to work for God. Say with me, moving to work for God. What I love about God and his love, he doesn't just talk it, but he shows it. Someone said a miracle is God meeting the need and doing something that we're not able to do. You know, many times, I think if we're not careful, we can take God for granted and we underestimate that he's a God that does heal all manner of disease. He heals all manner of sickness. And even though mankind scratches their head and they say, well, you know, I really can't do anything else for you, after they've taken all your money and have you run here, run there, sometimes you get to the end of your day and you're like, Lord, what did it all mean? But I want you to understand today, not only does the Lord heal physically, but God also heals mind battles. How many of you have had some mind battles? Amen. God is able to heal your mind. He's able to heal our bodies. And as we look at this, I want to emphasize in this message for this afternoon, it's really the need to be able to delegate power or to give power out to individuals to carry forth the mission. Understand today that as a believer, you're not just to take the word of God and just sit on it, but God wants you to take your faith and to put it into action. When God sends you forth, he doesn't send you forth empty-handed. So he's got to give you two things. He's got to give you tools. Say with me, tools. And he's got to give you weapons. Say weapons. Tools are not weapons, and weapons are not tools. And we have to be able to be skillful to be able to use each one the way it was designed to be used. Understanding here, prayer is a strong weapon in the arsenal of the attack of the adversary. I do believe in our own country, and I love America. There's no other place I'd rather live than right here in the United States of America. No other place, even though I was born in Michigan, and underneath all this Hoosier redness, I'm somewhat of still a Wolverine. But I thank God because it was my choice to be here, amen, in Fort Wayne, Indiana. So I appreciate the freedoms, but I understand where they come from. The freedoms that we have today come from God. The benefit of being able to carry our Bible out in the open come from God. To be able to speak the name of Jesus openly, amen, come from God. But I do believe today we are in the midst of a culture war because I believe there is a season where the enemy feels like he has the right to attack believers or Christians. I say that because individuals that were in the closet or out of the closet, out in the open. And if you want to live with whoever you want to live with, if it's two men or two women, that's your thing. But I do believe when you touch the arena of marriage, which was instituted by God, I believe you're, if I could use the word, messing with something that you're not supposed to put your hands on. Amen. When the Lord put Adam to sleep, he said, Adam, first of all, it's not good that you be alone. I'm going to make you a help meet. Brothers, let's understand our wives are not our slaves. Amen, somebody. Our wives are not our servants. I hope to get some amens over that. Amen? But they are to help us. And how are they to help us? Comically, we had a sister that used to belong to our church, and she threw out the phrase, I'm here to help my husband. I'm going to help meet him at the door and help spend his money. Not that type of help. Not that type of help. Some people are takers and some are users, but the helper that I believe God allowed you to choose is somebody that's got to help you see God more clearly now than you ever seen him before. Amen. I look at this here, and I believe that it is open season by the adversary to attack true faith, faithful believers. But as I look at this, I believe it's even more important here for us to be able to understand that we have a God that cares about us. As you look at the text here, we look and see here, as we started at verse number 35, Jesus went about all the cities and villages teaching in the synagogue and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel. The gospel really has more to do than just with the spirit man. We care about the whole person. You've heard the phrase being holistic. We care about your bodies being in good health. Amen. We don't want your blood pressure to be high. Amen. We don't want you to be have your sugar level out of whack. Amen. We don't want your body swelling and having issues. And understand that not only do we just care about it, but God cares about it too. Amen. So the whole person, understand as we look at this, Jesus went about in all the cities and villages teaching in their synagogue and preaching, which tells me Jesus has a heart for his creation. You might say, well, Pastor, Jesus has gone away. Yes, he is. But it was very important for him to go away, because if he didn't go away, the Holy Ghost, amen, the Comforter that he spoke about, the promise of the Father, would not come. But since he went away, he said, I'm going to send back power to you as a believer. And he told us here, as you look at the text, how we ought to be praying. If you got your Bibles open, and hopefully you still do, look at verse number 38, and let's read verse number 38 aloud and together. Pray ye therefore, what does Jesus say? Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. I want you to understand today, if Jesus was moved with compassion because he saw a great number of people, he was moved. When you think about compassion, you have to think about mercy. He was moved by this. He says, because as he looked at the sheep, they were scattered in verse number 36 as having no shepherd. Understand today, you need to have a church home. You need to be amongst believers, all right, that believe and care about God the way you do. Amen. You need to have a family that's going the same direction that you're going. And I know the Bible says the foes should be there of your own household, so sometimes it's not that easy because, and I'm really happy to see families in the house of the Lord, because sometimes it doesn't work like that. Sometimes somebody wants to go to the church and somebody wants to come, and sometimes the other person wants to stay at home. And you find yourself having to try to pull, and you get very frustrated, and you just, like, you know, it doesn't work well. But understand here, somebody has got to be a leader. Somebody has got to go forth. As we look at verse number 38, the Lord tells us how to pray. Pray, therefore, the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers. I want to ask you the question today, are you really moved by doing the work of the Lord? So, Pastor, what do you mean the work of the Lord? Well, the work of the Lord does not mean necessarily you have to be called to the ministry. Sometimes when people feel a calling of the Lord, they think, well, I think God wants me to preach, or I think God wants me to pastor. And that's a, you know, a great profession, but make sure that it's the Lord calling you, and that, you know, you don't feel that by any other type of sense coming from the wrong sense of motivation, because it's a very serious calling. But understand that as a believer, God has called all of us to the ministry of reconciliation. Now, what this means here, all of us are ministers to reconcile the world back to God. So when we look at the word laborer here, it does not have to mean a preacher or an evangelist, But God has called all of us to work in, look at the notes here, it says, his harvest. Amen. You think about a harvest, you think about what you get after you commit labor. Think about a harvest, you have to think about there's got to be a time to sow the seed. Here in Indiana, of course, and like other areas, we wait for the springtime because the weather's right to till up the ground and to plant the seed. Understand here, the first obligation has to do with identification. Do you see yourself as a worker for God? Identification. The Lord knew this work was so great and he was moved. That's why I wanted us to read here the 10th chapter, verse number 1. He called unto them his 12 disciples and he gave them power against what? Unclean spirits. Look at verse number 1 here. Not only did he give them power, it says, to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Amen. Let's give God some praise in the house. Amen. The Bible lets us know as many as he has received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. If we're not careful, many times we'll look in the text and we say, well, yes, that power went to the disciples. And they had to face what Jesus faced in his day. But I want you to understand today, that power wasn't just for the disciples and for the 12 of that day. That power is for every believer today. Amen. How many understand today, with everything that's on your plate, you need a special anointing in your life to be able to handle and bear up under the weight of what's just going on in your life? You need more power. You need a special anointing. Amen. You need a special grace. And if you got people that aren't going in the same direction with you, amen, join with unbelievers, you need a special grace. I want you to understand today, it first starts with identification. Knowing that God has called, you have to say, me, to do his work. What type of work is it? Well, it's something as simple as what we learned in Sunday school. Sister Johnson gave words of expression. She is working at one of the hospitals here, and she said she was walking up and down the aisles and just singing a song, not bothering anybody, what have you, but one of the patients in the room said, what's that noise out there? And she replied and said, that's me. He said, what are you doing out there? Well, I'm just singing for the Lord. And the man called her in the room, and really was a test of faith, amen. And she's sitting right back there. You can verify this. She shared that with us just earlier this morning. And he really was challenging her on her faith in God. She understood her right as a believer that she didn't have to cower down to the evil atmosphere. And understand, as a believer, you do not have to cower down or shun the gospel that God put within you. The best news ever told is what Jesus did for us way back on Calvary. Amen? You're not going to find that good news, amen, in the Journal Gazette. You're not going to read the paper of the New York Times to find that good news. But get this, somebody's got to read that in your life. Your life today, Paul talked about it being a living epistle, a letter. But today, let me bring it up to 2017. How many texts today? You know, when cell phones came out, I said I was never going to text. If you want to get a hold of me, you better call me. Well, that changed. I'd rather throw out a text now than answer a call, if I'm able to, amen? Which means here, again, it goes back to never say you're never going to do something, because if it's a way that God has a tool or an opportunity, never tell yourself here, I'm never going to be fit for the kingdom of God. Let me go back here to the story that our sister shared. So she was just walking up and down the aisles, and the man said, what is that noise? And he said, it's me singing. I said, what are you singing about? I'm singing about the goodness of the Lord. So she went into his room, and then the man asked her, I believe, about prayer. He said, do you believe in praying? Yes. Well, who do you pray to? I pray to Jesus. And the man said, and said, "Will you pray?" And he asked her, "Will you pray for me?" And she said, "Yes, I will." Then the man rejected, closed the door, said, "Well, I don't want your prayer." Well, why would you do all that to get upset and for the believer to come into the room and then close the door? But what I want you to show here, in that instance, and I'm talking about Sister Johnson now, this is her testimony, by doing her everyday work, she had an opportunity to be a laborer in the hospital. She's paid to help sick people, but yet she was a laborer right where she worked. See, God wants the same thing for you. See, young people in the house today, young people, you got relationships with other young people that I don't know. And God wants you to work in the kingdom. God wants you to share your testimony. You may not be on drugs, but you might know somebody that's wheeling and dealing and selling. You may not know somebody specifically that was shot or killed, but you know a friend of a friend. So when you think about, if I can use the word, the web or the circle of your influence, there's got to be a way for you to be able to get the gospel, the good news, to people you care about. Identification. Somebody say that. Identification. Along with identification, seeing yourself as a laborer, many times we look at the text and say, "Well, I'm praying, Lord, send forth laborers into the harvest." But God is saying, "What about you?" Moses started to complain and said, "Well, Lord, you want me to go down and tell Pharaoh, let your people go?" And he started to say, "Well, Lord, I can't even speak right. And God said, "I'm going to send you some help." Sometimes we have some, apprehensions about our own self, about what we're able to do or not. But I want to tell you today, when you look and see what Jesus sees, how can you not be moved when people are hurting today? And my son is a millennial. He's 26, and he knew a lot of people within the last couple of years, friends, amen, associates that are no longer here, friends that never see their 30th birthday because they're dead. Amen. Thought that they would live forever, but what I'm telling you today here, because we live in such an evil, wicked world, when the Lord was moved with compassion, he was moved because they had no shepherd. So first of all, as we look at this here, you have to be moved to care enough about people. You can't say, "I'm a believer, but I only care about my family." No, it doesn't work like that. You can say, "I believe in God, but I don't care about the people on my job." No, you got to care about them. Amen. Amen. And yeah, that's right. And yeah, that's right. Let's give him praise. Amen. Because if anybody needs Jesus, come on, it's perhaps the people on your job that have a tendency to raise hell on your job. Amen. Amen. If there's anybody that needs Jesus, it's the one that's giving you a hard time. And I know what you think. Many times you look at those individuals, you say, "Well, they need not only a little more Jesus, they need a whole lot of Jesus." And we write them off and say, "They ain't going to get saved. I ain't even going to waste my time on them." Have you ever done that? There was a man in the Bible by the name of Saul. Later he became an apostle, called out of due time, known, amen, as the Apostle Paul. And this man thought he was doing God a service by, rallying up the Christians, throwing them in jail, and killing the Christians. And the Bible says in the text, and we didn't read it, but you can check it out, it's in the book of Acts, he was a terrorist against Christians. And I believe God said, "Is anybody I need to get a hold of? This is one big devil I need to get a hold of. Because if anybody can do a great work in the kingdom, if he can use all that energy that he did, thinking he was doing God a service, God said, if I can just put my hands on him and turn him around, that man's going to be a great vessel." Amen. Come on, let's give him praise. What I'm telling you this afternoon, believer, is that some of the biggest devils out there will make the best saints in the kingdom. And if we were to draw back the curtains in your life, oh, Lord, help us. Were there any people in your life that said you would never be where you are today? Somebody say, "But God." And they could never see you in church because of your past old life. Somebody say, "But God." See, God has got the last word. And see, this is, let me show you how God works. God puts his identification. He already has a badge, a duty, a job to be filled in the kingdom for you when he calls you. But you don't understand, you know, what that responsibility is until he calls you. Once he calls you, he's got to equip you and give you the tools and give you the weapons to be able to go forth. As I look at this here, and there's a saying, people really don't care how much you know about the word until they really know how much you really care. Don't quote a bunch of scriptures to somebody, but don't take them across town when they need a ride to the store. Don't quote a bunch of scriptures to people when you got a little extra change in your pocket and you see they're hungry. Amen. Come on, somebody. Don't look at somebody in disgust and say, you know, they got beat up and tore up and poor them and just step on over them. No. The good news says, I got to stop and take the time out to be the good Samaritan. I got to be that laborer. How many know that love starts where? Come on, what's the saying? Love starts where? At home. So get this. If we're not helping, first of all, our own house, don't spend time across the street, across town, helping out Mrs. Smith when your own house is falling apart. Love starts where? At home. It starts with the priority saying, I got to be a light. I got to be a witness to my son, my daughter, my grandchildren. I got to be a worker for God. Amen. I just want to inspire you this afternoon to be moved to work for God. The greatest reward today is to be able to work and know that I got a word I can give somebody a hope about who Jesus is. To the gangbanger out there thinking, well, I can make a whole lot of money out doing this and letting them know that you're living in dangerous times, because it's just a matter of time before you end up in two places. You either end up dead or you end up in jail. But if I'm a worker for the Lord, you don't have to end up in jail. How many of you know our young black men especially, and this is Black History Month, they do not have to end up behind the bars. But they need somebody that's willing to work for them. See, when you're working for God, you're working on behalf of somebody else. And so we need, amen, young people. We need young ladies. We need young men. God is saying here, I'm calling, amen, the sent forth laborers. And I believe as we look at this, we are the answer to somebody's prayers. Did you ever see yourself as an answer to somebody's prayers? You have to understand as we look at this also that the work for God is worthwhile. So sometimes it takes years working in the ground of somebody's heart before they can really believe in you. See, what we're talking about, we're not talking about inviting somebody out to God. What we're talking about is being transparent enough to let somebody see how broken your life used to be and how better it is now since you met the man Christ Jesus. Come on, somebody. See, when the Bible says here that the Lord gave them power, let me help you out. The power that God gives us is the power of his word, because his word is not only the spoken word, but his word is God. And when you preach the word over somebody, you give them the opportunity to have new life that they never had before. You mix in that word with your own life experience, and you end up with what we call a testimony. So the word of God plus your own experiences equal a testimony. Bring those two factors in together, and that is a powerful 1-2 punch. Because we read about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We read about Daniel in the lion's den, but it's a whole different story when you see a Daniel of 2017. It's a whole different story when we see somebody that's been thrown in a fiery furnace of affliction, and you came out like the three Hebrew boys without smelling like smoke. So this gospel has got to become alive. This gospel has got to be relative and pertinent to 2017. It will never make sense to a world as they look into the word of God unless the word is alive and moving today. Let's give them some praise. Amen. As we look at this, I'm getting ready to take my seat here. I believe we have to be caring enough to make a true difference. We have to be caring enough to be able to say here, Lord, I'll be that Moses to somebody to lead them by the hand out of their trial. We have to be caring enough to let that person that's caught up in an abusive relationship to let them know you don't have to stay there. Amen. Let's give him praise. Amen. Told you last week about the prodigal son, and he said, I want my inheritance, and he got it. And then he said, Dad, I'm out of here, and he split. But I believe when we look at the worth of the work, somebody say with me, the worth of the work. The worth of the work is knowing I can take this word, which is a seed, and I can share it with somebody, my testimony, what God has done, and my life can help save somebody from future trouble. My life can help save somebody from future struggles. Come on, somebody. See, your life has got to be so important and so powerful. It's got to have a potency about it, being the salt, praise God, that God has given you to let somebody know that when you speak, there's something about the words that come out of your mouth. Those words are anointed. And how many of you know people are going to look at you? People are going to examine you. As I told you about the man, amen, who was in the hospital, and he told Sister Johnson, you know, come on in here. And he said, will you pray for me? And she said, yes, I would. And it was his slip up to say, I don't want prayer. He missed out on his blessing. But I believe here, we must not leave the world with any excuses why somebody didn't stand up and really tell me about who Jesus is. Let's give him praise. Amen. Amen. Somebody, amen. Let's give God praise in the house. Today we need to be moved, amen, to work for God. Jesus understood the daunting task of how, amen, the multitude was so large and so big. And he said here, they followed me way out here in the wilderness. And he said, I can't send them back because along the way they're going to faint. He said, here, pray the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers. And it has come to let you know here today that God has called you to be a laborer in the kingdom. Amen. You may not be able to put a three-point sermon together, but what you can do, you can lay hands on somebody and you can let them know that I'm praying for you right here and now. Amen. In your own situation. Let's give him praise. Amen. I believe right now you can make the difference in somebody's life. I'm not talking about a pep talk, and I'm not talking about inflating your ego, but what I'm talking about you really being, amen, the light of the world and the salt of the earth today. If there's ever a time where the world is so sick and people are so hurt and people are so depressed and people are so down and out that they need the church, the true believer, to stand up and be the church, and child of God, 2017 is the time, and I believe you got what it takes today to stand up and let God be real. Amen. Amen. Let's give him some praise in the house today. I believe we must not let the enemy, amen, try to psych us out in our mind. The devil will lie to you. He'll make you think, well, you haven't done anything great. But when you think about, amen, what God has already brought you through, and we've got some single parents that have gone through some hardships, but nevertheless, you're still loving God and serving God. Amen. Amen. Praise God. You got a testimony to tell somebody. Amen. We've got some men, praise God, in the house of the Lord who were serving God and loving God, and through no fault of their own, amen, their wives walked out on them, and they, amen, committed adultery, and they walked out, but yet men kept on living for God. Hello, somebody. Amen. We got people in the house of the Lord that once had cancer, no longer have cancer, and they also are laborers in the house of the Lord. Amen. Come on, let's give them praise in the house, huh? Amen. We got people of the house, amen, that used to deal drugs and used to sell drugs and used to get high and used to get their drink on. But God has pulled them out of that Egypt and pulled them out of that bondage. And God has put within them a new story and a new message and given them a new reason to live and a new reason to get out of bed and a new reason to have a smile on their face. Come on, somebody. When we think about the goodness of Jesus, amen, we've got a 1,000 reasons to be able to praise God, not only for what he has done, but I believe we got a million reasons to be able to be moved today to do the work for the Lord. The work for the Lord could be as easy, amen, as taking somebody across town, using your gas, using your car, and buying them a bag of groceries. Amen. Come on, somebody. The work of the Lord could be as easy as taking somebody to the doctor's office and saying, I can't wait with you, but I'll drop you off and I'll come back and get you on the way back. Just give me another ring. Amen. Come on, somebody, say with me, I'm moved to do the work for God. The work of God will get down to somebody who's depressed and down and out and feels like, amen, I can't go to nowhere else but to the streets. But I believe when you're moved today like Jesus was with compassion, I believe we that are enlightened by the word of God, we know, amen, the devices of the adversary. And we know, amen, that the devil would love to lure our children out there in the world. But somebody needs to stand in the gap. Amen. And again, I got to tell you, like last week, they don't have to go there. Amen. When you're moved to do the work of God, I believe you got to be moved today. And you got to have, I believe, like that superhero strength and that superhero, amen, courage today. You got to be willing to stand in front of all adversity and stand in places that you have never stood before and be able to call on God for things that you have never had to pray about before. Come on, somebody. Amen. I believe, amen, when you're moved to work for God, you got to be able to see and understand that God has got to give you vision spiritually that the other individuals don't have that type of vision. What I mean right now is that you've got to have a discernment and you've got to have an awareness. You've got to have an understanding that other people don't know God like you know him. Other people don't know that there's a real devil out there going about to stealing, killing, and destroying. But I believe today, as a laborer, you've also got to be able to take courage, amen, to say, look, I'm going to stand in front of you so the enemy cannot come one-on-one with you. And why am I going to stand in front of you? Because you need somebody that's willing to stand and go with you all along the way. There are too many people today, they're willing to say, I'm willing to pray for you, but they don't offer up any prayers. You don't need people that's willing to say, I'm going to pray for you. But you need somebody that's willing to get down in the pit with you. Amen. Get down in the foxhole with you. Somebody's willing to say, I'm willing to come and pray with you. And we got to pray all night long over this situation. I'll be that worker in your mess. I'll be that worker in your confusion. I'll be that worker when nobody else is around you and you've been left hanging. Somebody needs to walk with you and somebody needs to pray for you and somebody needs to understand how you've been beat up and what you went through. Somebody needs to understand, amen, all the things that you had to go through, because I believe like this, if you could never understand somebody else's situation, you could never be moved with compassion. And this is why we that have been through some things, if there's anybody that ought to have compassion in the house of God, in other words, if you used to drink and get high, you ought to be the first one on the street to tell somebody, amen, you don't need, amen, that Budweiser. God's got a better drink for you over here in the kingdom. Amen. You used to get high and used to do those things. Amen. That qualifies you to be a dynamic witness in the house of the Lord. Come on, somebody. Amen. When you're moved today with compassion, you're moved because you see how the enemy is tearing homes apart and you see how the enemy is tearing marriages apart. And you see, praise God, how, amen, our young people are being thrown to the wolves. But I believe you just can't feel, but you got to be able to be moved with enough energy and passion to do something about it. Amen. Is there anybody in the house today that's willing to say, Lord, I'm willing to stand up in a world that does not want to believe in you or call on your name? God, I'll be one of those that's willing today to say, Lord, here am I, send me to that young teenager that's trying to raise a baby all by herself, and she doesn't need the church that's willing to judge her or throw her away, but she needs somebody that's willing to show her how to be a young mother. Amen. Come on, somebody. We got some young men that made some babies out there in the streets, and no, they haven't been good fathers, and no, they haven't been, amen, good role models, but we need workers in the house of the Lord that's got to to be a good godly father in the house. There's got to be a good role model. Amen. I believe the Lord is saying, can I find a worker in the house today? Can I find a father that's willing to role model to be able to show the young generation coming up? Amen. You don't have to hit somebody upside the head. That love has nothing to do with beating somebody down. But real love today says you can put your hands down and you can love that woman as Christ loved the church. Come on, somebody, let's give them praise in the house today. I don't know what is it, amen, that will move you, but I believe here in closing, when we look back at Jesus, and we look back at what he did in this text here, he went about, the Bible says, in all the cities and villages. He went about teaching, amen, what individuals need today in this generation. Amen, we need individuals that are willing. God's got to put individuals out there that are teachers today. Amen. We don't need entertainers in the pulpit, but we need somebody that's willing to open the word of God and teach me what thus saith the Lord. Amen. You can get a hum and you can get a moan, but after it's all over, if you don't know what the preacher said, amen, then all you did was get, amen, your fancy tickled. But you need something more than that. You need good, solid teaching what holiness is about. You need good, solid teaching what it means to be a saved man or a saved woman. Come on, somebody. If Jesus taught in the synagogues, we need teachers today. Lord, help me to be a teacher. Amen. Help me to start with my own family. Help me to teach my son. And I believe he's off to a good start with 1 year of marriage to go and look for a godly woman. Amen. Help me to teach my daughter. You don't have to lower yourself and settle for anybody out there in the world. Amen. But God's got a good saved man for you out there. How many are saying, Lord, help me to be a teacher today? I just want to say, church, today, let's be moved. Let's be moved to work for God. Let's be moved today in a world that's in crisis, that needs to know, does anybody really care? Amen. Where the government is making you jump through all these hoops. We don't need the government to do God's work. We don't need a grant from the government to be able to tell somebody how good God is and how God wants to rescue you from that. Come on, somebody, let's exercise our liberty now. God is saying here, if you just receive me, I'm going to give you power today to make the difference in somebody's life. And there's no greater testimony than that. We look back, amen, in this Black History Month, and one of our great leaders is the Dr. Martin Luther King. He was the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. Amen. He had not only a dream, but he had a passion and a burden that black can get along with white and white can get along with black. Amen. That individuals would not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. But let me tell you something about it. The reason he had not only a dream, but he had a conviction because he talked with God. Amen. Let's give him praise in the house of God today. Amen. Don't come giving anybody any help if you haven't first prayed about it. If you haven't first talked to God. But if you talk to the master, then you got a right to tell me what the master says. If you went down on your knees in prayer and the Lord gave you a sure word, the Lord, amen, Jesus said, if they listen to me, they're going to listen to you. And I just want to let you know today, just like Saul was a mean terrorist, amen, and Ananias didn't want to witness to him, but the Lord said he is a chosen vessel. Do you understand today, as I told you, some of the biggest devils out there make the greatest saints of God. Amen. Ananias didn't want to witness to him. But the Lord had to say he's a chosen vessel. Amen. Why is he chosen? He's chosen to bring my name to the Gentiles. Come on, somebody. Let's give him praise. Amen. Amen. He looked at the Gentiles as being dogs, people that he didn't want to associate with. Being a Jew, he was caught up in the Jewish things. But I want to let you know today that when the Lord gets in it, God has got a way of changing your mind. Amen. If you today are filled with anger and animosity and hatred, just let the Lord get in. God will take that hatred out of your mind. God will take that envy out of your heart. God will take that jealousy out. And God said, before I send you forth, I'm going to make you fully equipped that you can let somebody know who Jesus is. See, somebody needs to know that you're real today, that you really care about them. You care about all of them. You care about if they're in good health. You care if they got money in their pocket. You care, amen, if their spiritual man is whole. I believe, amen, as a church, we got to care about the whole person. If Johnny is having problems at school and the teacher just want to kick Johnny out, then the church has got to care about that. We don't want our children kicked out of school. We want them in the classroom where they can learn. Come on, somebody. Amen. Let's give him praise. Amen. There's a thousand, a million ways to be a witness today. So in closing, let's ask the Lord, God, move me today to work for you. Move me today to step into my calling. God, move me today. Amen. Today and this week to make a difference in somebody's life before they blow their brains out. God, move me to get to them. Move me to make that phone call. Come on, somebody. Don't sit there and look at me. You ought to say, Lord, move me. Move me to a place that I've never been before. Move me, amen, to be a light where I've never shone before. God, move me off the seat of do nothing to be able to pick up my phone and let my own grandkids know that God loves them. Amen. Don't wait for them to call you. You be the mom. You be the grown-up. You be the dad. You initiate. You put the phone call out. Let them know how much God loves them. Come on, somebody. I want to say today, what's going to move you? Amen. I want the Lord to move you. In my closing, I reminded of the old song says, when the Lord gets ready, you got to move. What I believe the Lord is already right now. He said, come on, army of God. Put on your war clothes. Come on, army of God. Take off the sackcloth and ashes. Come on, army of God. Why sit there like you ain't got no power? God said, I've given you power today over every unclean thing. So you might got some people, you got some foul spirits out there. But God gave you power over those unclean, foul spirits. Well, if I witness to them, they're going to curse me out. Don't worry about those four-letter words. You're bigger than them words. Amen. Don't worry about them rejecting you. If they rejected you, no, they didn't reject you. They rejected Jesus. But the Lord will let them know that I sent my servant to you. In that time of judgment, God will bring back. God will reload the memory and let them know I sent my servant to you, but you didn't want prayer. I sent my servant to you, but you didn't have time for it. But I want to know, amen, but when you're moved to work for God, God's got a reward for you. Amen. It doesn't matter if they receive it or not. But Lord, move me. Come on, somebody. Let's ask the Lord to move us. Move me, God. Move me to give a word of encouragement. Move me, God. Move me into a state that says I got mine and I ain't caring about nobody else. That is a selfish, ungodly spirit. And you need to rebuke that back to the pit of hell. Amen. I don't care how long you've been saved. God didn't save you not to care about your neighbor. Who was my neighbor? You know the story, the one beaten up and left half dead. So it ain't got to be my son locked up. If it's your son locked up, then it's my son. Amen. If it's your daughter in the street, it's my daughter in the street. Come on, somebody. I believe today we can look at it the way God looks at it. God said, I ain't looking at your color. I ain't looking at what side of town you've been born on. I'm not looking at how big your house is, but I'm looking at your brokenness. I'm looking at your hurt. I'm looking at your pain. I'm looking at your disgust. And God God said, I can't leave you there because you're worth too much to me. And that's why God said, I move with compassion. I can only be in one place at one time. But the Lord Jesus said, I need some help. Now, if Jesus needed some help, I believe you need to call on help in your family. If somebody claims to love you, amen, you need to tell them, not ask them, come on and let us walk with God together. Amen. They can say they love you, but they ought to walk with you to God. They ought to pray with you to God. Come on, somebody. I'm talking about real love. Real love doesn't just say, let that word come out. But real love said, I want to serve your God. I want to go to your church. Amen. I want to read the Bible you're reading. I want to pray to the God you're praying about. I want the miracle you got. Come on, somebody. Let's give them praise in the house today. I believe, amen, when the Lord sees it, we got to see it too. So, Lord, in closing, open our eyes in 2017. Let us see when we leave the comforts of this building. Lord, help may be needed across the street. Let me be the one to get there. Help may be needed on the job. Believer, you got to get there. Your testimony, your word, you got to get there. And you got to be courageous. It don't have to be a long sermon, but you got to get your witness there. Your witness is only a witness when you can tell them what Jesus has done. When they look to you and ask you for a question, how'd you make it over? How'd you make it when that woman walked out on you, fooled around on you? How'd you make it? How'd you make it when that man left you with all them babies? How'd you make it? How'd you make it putting the Budweiser down? How'd you make it? How'd you make it not playing the numbers? How'd you make it? You got to let them know. It wasn't by my power. It wasn't by my might. It was by the Spirit of the Lord. And I believe if we can ask God to blow on us, Lord, breathe on us. Lord, move us today with mercy. Move us today with compassion. Move us today in a world that wants to put walls up. Amen. We got to care about the white man, even if he don't care about us. We got to care about the youth, if there are no programs. We got to care about the sick. Amen. And there's not another penny from Uncle Sam. The church has got to be the church. It's not a job, amen. Amen, for the people downtown. It's a job for the church. Amen. Come on, church, stand up. Amen. Let's let the Lord hire us today. God said, I want to send you forth as laborers. Lord, move me to do your work. And when I get done to the end of the day, and I lay my head on the pillow, I can say, thank you, Lord, for using me today. Thank you, God, for keep using me to keep somebody from going to hell. Thank you, God, for letting me have a word to somebody to know who Jesus is. If you want to let somebody know today, give them praise in the house. God has said, I'm giving you salt. I'm giving you light. But as a salt shaker, you got to shake it out right now. Come on, give your neighbor a high five. Say, let that salt out. Come on, let it out, believer. Let it out right now. Amen. Let the Lord move you to let it out. Let's stand all over the house. Come on down, altar workers. Yeah, let's give them praise in the house. Hallelujah. Come on, let's put them hands together. I move to work for God. And can I tell you something? When I move to work for God, everybody don't have to know that I'm working for God. I don't have to put a flyer out there and tell everybody I'm working for God. Amen? Because Mother White, when I'm working for God, I may have to go undercover. Amen. Amen. I don't want everybody to know, amen, what the Lord is up to. I may have to steal away in somebody's house. Amen. A safe house, if you please. And let somebody know who Jesus is. And I don't want the enemy across town to know what I'm doing. Because I don't want him to wreck, amen, what God is doing. So today, when the Lord called you to work for him, amen, let the Lord take you to places you've never been before. Lord, help me to be moved today. Moved to work for God. Yeah, let's give him praise. Hallelujah. The harvest is plenteous. Let's stand all over the house. The harvest. Amen. Everyone stand. The harvest, the harvest, the harvest. I'm the pastor of King's Chapel, but I don't live in your neighborhood. I'm the pastor of King's Chapel, but I don't go to your school. I'm the pastor of King's Chapel, but I don't work on your job. But your environment is where you live, where you move, where you have your being. And God has called you to work where you live. Let's lift those hands. Lord, help me to work for you where I live. So on my job, I got to be a light. When I'm riding the bus, I get to know people that are familiar faces. And on that bus, I may see them every week. Lord, don't let me ride that PTC bus without telling somebody about how good God is and what God could do for them. That might be the last time you see that person. Today, man, as AV gets ready to roll the song here, we'll roll this. And if you want prayer today, you want to be moved to work for the Lord, come on down right now. We want to lay hands on you. We want to pray for you in the name of the Lord. Amen? Amen. Let's give him praise. Let's give him worship in the house right now. The Lord cares for you today. Don't let the devil lie to you and say that you're not valuable. You are today. When I think about my life and how he rescued me, might have a small bank account, but that does not determine your wealth. And all the battles in my life. I'm a single parent trying to make it on myself. That doesn't determine your wealth. God cares for you. Yeah, let's give him worship, amen. Look back to Calvary and see how much he cares today. If you need prayer today, sick in your body, he cares. Going through a mind battle, God cares today. Amen. Won't you come? We want to pray for you. Going through a situation, God cares. Hallelujah. And Lord, if I need to stand in the gap and I'm going to meet somebody this week, let me be the one to show that not only does God care, come on, lift those hands and say, Lord, I care for them also. Yes, I care for them. If you need some reinforcement in prayer, come on down to the altar. If you know the calling in your life is great to be a witness, you need to be reinforced with prayer. Come on down. We want to pray for you. The Lord cares. Why don't you come right now? Let's come on. Put them hands together out there. You know he's good. Yeah, let's give him worship. God, you're so good.
Good God.
If you need prayer, come on down. If you want to be baptized in Jesus' name, right now we have water. You can be baptized in the name of the Lord, and God will fill you with the gift of the Holy Ghost. Amen? Amen. Won't you come right now? If you want to be baptized, we'll be glad to baptize you, and all your sins will be washed away. Amen? God will fill you up with the gift of the Holy Ghost.